the Higgs particle is a concept which is really, if you want to understand it in an honest way, one has to understand quantum field theory. So I have to make some compromises that I'm assuming that many of you don't know quantum field theory, but still would like to know what Higgs particle is. So in doing so, I'll have to go through a series of arguments, and which will require a certain amount of attention on your part, because, and this is like, here I would like to quote Steven Weinberg, who starts his beautiful book on early universe called The First 3 Minutes by saying that I picture the reader, and for me it's a viewer, as a smart old attorney who does not speak my language, who don't know quantum field theory, but who expects nonetheless to hear some convincing arguments before he or she makes up his mind. Another caveat which I would like you to keep in mind is a famous quote by Niels Bohr, which says the complement of truth is clarity. Truth and clarity are complementary. So often when I'll be honest and truthful, I may not be clear because of the technical, necessary technical language complications involved. And often when I may be clear, I may not be entirely truthful. Okay, with this caveat, let me start. Our understanding of the universe, right now at least, is a journey which is what we call an inward bound. It's a journey in which we go looking at the laws of nature by probing the nature at a shorter and shorter distances. The journey, in a sense, started with the structure of atom. Many of us know that it was Rutherford who discovered that the atom itself is made up of a central nucleus and that there are electrons around the nucleus. Since then, over almost 100 years or more, we have been probing this this structure more and more deeper at a shorter and shorter distances. So now we know that the nucleus itself is made up of certain particles we call protons and neutrons, which in turn, now we know, are in themselves made up of quarks and gluons. These building blocks, together with the forces that hold together and their mathematical description, has been given a name called the Standard Model. It is called the Standard Model because this is the model which has been accepted by a vast majority of physicists, not because of any consensus, but because experimentally it has been verified a countless number of times now. So this version of universe, this description of universe says that it is made up of certain elementary particles. Everything that you see around you is literally made up of certain particles which are either quarks, so they form protons and neutrons, or they are electrons which combine with protons and neutrons to form atoms. So these are the quarks, and there are leptons, and these particles interact with each other through some forces, and these forces are mediated through some other particles which are the force carriers, which I'll be discussing later. And then, as you'll see on the right-hand corner, there's this unique particle, the Higgs boson, and we will come to this, which is what the focus of this talk is, the role of this particle. So the thing which I want you to carry around is that the Standard Model is a theory which says that there are elementary blocks, which we call quarks and leptons. Lepton, you can think of as an electron. Quarks combine to form protons and neutrons. And they interact through forces, which are there are four types of forces of which we are aware of in nature. One is, two of them are familiar, which is gravity and electromagnetism. Gravity is the force which keeps the Earth going around Sun, which is responsible for the probable apple to fall. And electromagnetic forces are the forces through which we see the world around us, the light. There are two other forces which we are not so familiar with because they operate at a very short range, and they are called the nuclear forces. One of them is the weak force, which I'll be talking a lot more later on. Another is a strong force. Now, there are some properties of this force which I would like you to keep in mind. It is what we call a long-range force. In fact, when you are thinking that it is a long-range force is that the light can go on traveling forever and ever. And that is what I mean by that it's a long-range force. Now, there's another property of this force, the electromagnetic force that we see, which is rather abstract but will play a very important role. This force is a property that if you look at anything around you, or you look at a watch and you look at the image of the watch in the mirror, then you can imagine that you could build the watch which is a mirror image of the original watch. So every gear or every part in your watch would be, in this mirror watch, you would take a reflection of that part and use that reflected part to assemble a new watch. Now, new watch will behave as well as the old watch. Of course, it won't go in the clockwise direction if you're looking at the analog watch, but it will go in an anti-clockwise direction. But it will work as well as other. So that is to say that this force does not make any distinction between what we see and what we would see in a mirror world. This looks as a bit abstract and obtuse property, but we'll see it plays a very, very important role. The other thing which I would like to keep in mind, I would like you to keep in mind, is that with every force we associate a particle which in some sense mediates or carries that force. For electromagnetic force, it is photon. Photon is the particle from which light is made up of. this figure on the top is a sort of a ubiquitous figure which we draw in physics called Feynman diagram. And here it just shows that two electrons are coming from left to right, and they exchange this particle, which is the wavy line there, and that is the so-called virtual photon, and they get scattered. So everything that we see around us, anything that involves seeing, is really through an interaction like this. This electron on the left-hand side could be the electron on my molecules on my face, and the right-hand side electron, in some sense, could be the electron in your retina in your eyes, and that's the interaction we are talking about, and that's the electromagnetic interaction. So there is another force which we are not very familiar with, and which we, and the reason we are not aware of it is because it operates at a very, very short distances. It operates only inside the nucleuses which make up our atoms. This is a force which plays a very important role, and as we'll see later, it is the force which is responsible in a very critical way for the nuclear fusion which takes place inside the sun, which is a source of energy. It is a force which is responsible for the radioactive decay. Now, there are some of the important properties of this force which I would like you to keep in mind. It is short range in the sense that two particles which interact through this force feel this force only when they are very, very close to each other. How close? They have to be inside the, they have to be roughly at a distance which is the size of a nucleus. Now, to imagine, to get some feeling for the size of a nucleus, imagine that I could expand the whole of an atom into a big stadium, like a big cricket stadium. If I do that, then still the nucleus would, after even having expanded atom to a size of a stadium, the size of nucleus would be size of a fly buzzing around in that nucleus. So nucleus is extremely small, and it is in, and this weak interaction, the force which is responsible for radioactivity, operates at a very short distance. That's the distance which is the out of the size of the nucleus. As I mentioned, that it is the force which is responsible for radioactive decay. Now, it has one very, very important property, and which is very unexpected, and it was only discovered in around 1950s. It is a property that if you looked at some process which involves this weak interaction, that is the two particles interacting through a weak force, and you looked at the same process in a mirror, you would find that if you look at the mirror image, you would find that the mirror image never really occurs in the nature. Now compare it with the electromagnetic case. If I take two particles which are interacting with electromagnetic force, so I have two particles coming, they interact through exchanging light, I put some kind of a mirror, some sort of a mirror in the sense of a conceptual mirror, and in the mirror world, I take a mirror image of each of this particle, and then I find that the forces between the mirror image of this particle is identical to the original force. But in the case of the weak interaction, this does not happen. The weak interaction, in some sense, makes a distinction. Now, so often we say that it makes distinction between left and right, because when we look at in the mirror, our left and right side of the face seems to be interchanged. So weak interaction is a force which makes a distinction between left and right, while electromagnetism is a force which does not make any distinction between left and right. The particles that mediate the weak interactions, first of all, there are three types of them, which I have shown on the top diagram. They're called Z naught, W plus, W minus. And the other thing which we'll have to keep in mind is that these particles have a mass. In fact, the fact that these particles have a mass is very intimately related with the fact that the weak interaction is a short-range interaction. This interaction plays a very, very important role, for example, as I mentioned in the beginning, in initiating the fusion reaction. For fusion to start in sun, we have to first form what I call the deuterium. Deuterium is a nucleus made up of proton and neutron. For deuterium to form, there are lots and lots of protons, which are nothing but the nucleus of hydrogen. Two protons will not like to form a deuterium because they like to repel. But what happens is that one of the protons can get converted into neutron, and proton and neutron can combine together to form what we call a deuterium. And that deuterium then can later fuse with another deuterium and form helium, which leads to the energy release, which is responsible for life on Earth, for example. So radioactivity, which is an example of this thing, and the weak interactions are extremely important, not just as an abstract forces, but for the very existence of the life as we know. Okay, now, so at this point I've described you two kind of forces which look very, very different. One is the electromagnetic force, one is the weak force. Remember, electromagnetic force is the light through which we see the universe literally. It has a property that it does not diminish. It can never become zero. It can diminish, but never become zero. So we call it a long range. While there's a weak force, which becomes almost zero if the distance between the particle is larger than the size of a nucleus. And another important property which is that the electromagnetic force respects the left-right symmetry, that what you see in the mirror is possible. Really, you could do some, actually make what you see in the mirror in the real world, while the weak interaction does not respect that. So there's a way of distinguishing between left and right using weak interaction. Now, these two disparate forces, turns out, through this long story which I'll start, can be thought of as an aspect of a one single force, and that was a hugely surprising thing. To appreciate this, let's look at a little bit in more detail the particle of light which conveys the electromagnetic force, the photon. Now, as I mentioned, this particle has a zero mass. It does not have any mass, and it travels with, of course, at the speed of light, because it's the particle of light. This particle, in certain sense, spins. It spins in a... So if you think of a particle, as I've shown in the diagrams there, if it is moving along the right-hand direction, it could be spinning in the way like a ball which spins in a counterclockwise. So this is the... in the left-hand side, I've shown a particle which is spinning, and the arrow of spin is using my... as if I'm curling my fingers around that spinning ball, and if it is spinning along this direction, then I associate the direction of spin along my thumb. So this direction of spin is along the direction in which the photon is moving. So we call that a right-handed photon. And similarly, I could have other way around, that the photon is moving in this direction but is spinning in opposite direction. These two type of photons are responsible for what we call polarization. Some of you may be familiar with the lenses which are polarizer, so which shades certain. So if you look through at a sunlight through a polarizer, you find it darkens because it only allows one of the two types of the light particles, either the right-handed or the left-handed.